Romans chapter 9. This is the part of Romans where most people start their study of Romans, unfortunately. I don't know how many times I have had young men go away to Bible college or seminary, and it hasn't actually happened that much recently. But to have them call me and say, "Pastor, I have some questions about Romans 9. And I always ask them, and I say, "Well, I'd be happy to answer your questions. Have you read the rest of Romans?" And I say, yeah, I've read it. So, okay, well, tell me what Romans chapters 1 through 7, for instance. Give me an outline of it. Tell me what material is covered in Romans 1 through 7. "For I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it's the power of God and salvation, everyone that believeth." And they give you a real, you know, on-the-surface answer about Romans 1 through 7. It's really interesting to me that most believers are not all that terribly interested in studying Romans, say, chapters 13 through 16, or Romans chapter 1 through 7, but they love chapter 8 and chapter 9, because they don't want to get into Scripture and understand God, His character, and His Word. They want to understand theology or doctrine. And I'll just say to you, if you don't know, if you cannot outline Romans chapter 1 through 7, you have not a clue what Romans chapters really 9, 10, 11, and 12 are all about. They're about Israel. They're bringing us to the place where we look at one of the themes that we are introduced to right away in Romans, and that is the Jew first and also to the Greeks, Jews and Gentiles, all part of this church, and where do they fit in God's plan? And this is, as we are entering into this or transitioning into this portion of material in Romans, we're actually coming into some things that are hard for Paul, the apostle, to the Gentiles to write. And so last week we were somewhat introduced. Where we've been so far, we've seen, begin with the responsibility of all men to receive the gospel. We had it explained to us that all men are accountable not only for the gospel, we also had the simplicity of the gospel explained. And it's called in Romans the law of faith. And it's important Bible doctrine, and it very, very plainly lays out that salvation is by faith. It's by faith. And then, in response to the critic of the simplicity of the gospel, the Apostle Paul deals with, quite a bit of material, dealing with spiritual victory and helping us to understand that, hey, by faith we receive eternal life. And our life comes because of Christ's life, that is, His resurrection. But an important part of the doctrine of salvation, the gospel, is the death, the burial, and the resurrection. An important aspect of the gospel is the death of Jesus Christ, and it's very significant for Christians, for believers, that Jesus died. Make sure when you share the gospel that you don't just bypass the important aspect of the truth that Jesus died. You know, a lot of people don't think they need to be saved because they don't realize the cost, I think, of salvation. I've heard people say before, I just don't need Jesus. I just want God to judge me, deal with me individually. Well, friend, you need Jesus. You need Jesus because of your sin, and Jesus died for your sin. But when it comes to the Christian life, spiritual victory is all about the death of Christ. And that's what we learn as we particularly focus on that in Romans chapter 6. We learn that we, because Jesus is dead, we are also dead. In other words, in God's mind, any person who has received the gospel, Jesus died for them. And so because Jesus died in their place, they are dead, right? So any person who's born again, God looks at with regard to sin, He looks at them as dead. And so any believer who thinks that sin is an option is delusioned about the death of Christ on his behalf. My friend, Jesus did not give His life for part of yours. He gave all of His life for all of yours. And so you're completely, with regard to sin, you are completely, thoroughly dead. And that's the way God looks at it. And I've asked the question each week, and I think it's an important one. If God thinks you're dead and you think you're alive, who's delusional? You are God.
We are,
right? So if as a believer, I'm struggling, I'm saying, well, you know, I'm struggling with sin. Well, there is a very, very basic problem with the way that you're thinking. That's why Romans 6 says, likewise, reckon ye yourselves also to be dead indeed in sin. Now, we're reckon, of course, is an accounting term that has to do with basically balancing or getting your thinking straight. If God thinks I'm dead and I think I'm alive, then I need to fix my thinking. I need to reckon. So on purpose, I need to change my thinking. Christian, I want to tell you something. This is not oversimplification. You'll be amazed if you're struggling with spiritual victory. You'll be amazed at how simple it is to get up in the morning and just acknowledge the death of Christ in your life. And just say, I'm dead. Jesus died for me. I'm dead. I'm dead to sin. Dead to sin. Dead to sin. Dead to sin. But I'm alive unto righteousness. I'm alive unto God. I cannot sin. Not because my body is not physically able to do so, but because I'm dead. It's just amazing how if you agree with God about that simple matter, the victory that you can have. It is so simple and yet is a transformational truth. And the Apostle Paul spends quite a bit of time dealing with that. Then he deals with the hypothetical accusations for a person who would say, well, then you're saying that the law doesn't matter, that God gave the law of Moses and the law doesn't matter. And of course, we understand that that isn't what the Apostle Paul was saying at all. We understand the law has a purpose, and one of its purposes is that sin could be exceedingly sinful. And the law is very good, but we're the ones who are sold unto sin. So we looked at that. We have been studying that for several weeks, and I can't recap everything. But we've seen the responsibility of all men to receive the gospel. We've seen the simplicity of the gospel by faith, and the importance of the death of Christ and life of victory. And then last week, we concluded with eternal security. And perhaps one of the verses that is a banner verse or verses that you ought to be have memorized. By the way, if you're looking for verses to memorize so you don't have to run a mile this week, how about this? For I am persuaded that neither death nor life nor angels nor principalities nor powers nor things present nor things to come nor height nor depth nor any other thing shall be able to separate us from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. And so Paul concludes by helping believers to understand that when they have eternal life by faith, they are inseparably connected. They have eternal life forever. They literally are in the love of God. They cannot be separated from. And that is not our love for God. That is God's love. So God's love is so strong, my friend, that if you have believed in Christ by faith, it is inseparable. You cannot separate yourself. Neither can anything or anyone else separate you from God's love. So let's look at our text this morning, if you will, please. We're going to actually cover quite a great deal of Romans 9. I hope to be through this portion of the Scripture by the time we're finished here today, but if not, that'll just be how it comes out. But look down with me in chapter 9 and verse 30. We'll read our text, and then we'd better ask the Lord for help. So chapter 9 and verse 30, we see a conclusion to chapter 9. So we'll read the conclusion, then we'll pray, and then we'll look at how we got there. What shall we say then? That the Gentiles, which followed not after righteousness, have attained to righteousness, even the righteousness which is of faith. But Israel, which followed after the law of righteousness, hath not attained to the law of righteousness. Wherefore? Because they sought it not by faith, but as it were by the works of the law, for they stumbled at the stumbling stone, that stumbling stone, as it is written, Behold, I lay in Sion a stumbling block and rock of offense, and whosoever believeth on him shall not be ashamed. This is Isaiah 28, and specifically that quote is from verse 18. So literally our conclusion is, what is our conclusion? Well, Israel, which had the law of righteousness, they followed the law of righteousness, did not achieve righteousness. The Gentiles, who did not have the law of righteousness, but believed by faith, did achieve righteousness. And so once again, we have a reiteration of the simplicity of the gospel. The means to receive the gospel is simple faith. And that's our conclusion. Now, it's interesting as well, I mentioned earlier, let's pray and ask God's help, and then we'll get into some more commentary on this. Father, thank you for this passage of Scripture, and thank you for the help that it gives us in discerning between, Lord, even dispensations, times that you were working through Israel and working through the church. And God, I pray that as it was your desire for the saved Jewish believers as well as the Gentile believers to come together with an understanding of your purpose and plan in the age in which they lived, that we would come together with the understanding of the same, with the same results. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So we looked at the conclusion first to help us to understand where we get to. If you don't read the conclusion, you can go off and start reading the hypotheticals. In other words, in this passage of Scripture, we have mentioned Isaac and Ishmael. We have Jacob and Esau. And we have a reference to Pharaoh. And anytime someone studies these individuals without the context of Romans, they come to the conclusion that God selected for failure Ishmael, and God selected for failure Esau, and God selected for failure Pharaoh as well. And that is not at all what the passage of Scripture is teaching. What shall we say then? That's our conclusion. What are we going to conclude? Well, our conclusion is that the Gentiles who did not have the law of righteousness found righteousness or achieved righteousness by faith. But the Israel who had the law of righteousness, and they didn't achieve righteousness because they lacked faith. And so our conclusion ultimately, what we're going to come down to today, is that salvation is by faith. My friend, understand this. It does not take a, what's the word we put together? Rocket surgeon. I like that word. It doesn't take a rocket surgeon to realize that faith is a word that has to do with the will. Faith means believe. And belief in and of itself, the very concept of believing, is a choice. You know that? Unbelief is also a choice, every bit as much as believing is. An individual who believes something ultimately does so because he chooses to. Let me ask a question, somewhat personal. Have you ever not believed something in spite of the evidence for something? I know people. I mean, I'll be honest with you. You can give them the evidence and they still won't believe it. I mean, just, I don't believe it. I've done it. I can think of a couple instances, but it made me look bad, so I won't tell you about them. But I can think of a couple instances where I've been wrong about something. I'll tell you why I was wrong about it, because it's what I wanted to believe. I believed what I wanted to, and even though it was wrong, I still believed it. And when it came right down to it, it came down to this: these are my facts that I choose, and this is what I choose to believe. It's not a weakness for a believer to come to God by faith. That's not a strength. I mean, it is not a position of weakness. It's actually a position of strength. The evidence supports your faith. But we don't get saved because of evidence. We get saved because we believe. And belief is a choice of the will. And so I want us to understand, first of all, when we come into this passage of Scripture, that we're not talking about Esau, who was born a profane individual and never had a choice to believe. We're not talking about Ishmael, who, you know, just happened to have the wrong mother, and so he never had a choice to believe. We're talking about individuals who chose God and rejected Him. By the way, the line of Christ, isn't it sweet that in the line of Christ there are individuals such as Tamar, that there are individuals such as Rahab, that there are individuals such as Ruth, who though they would have been outsiders, yet because of their faith, and believing God, they were grafted into God's plan. They didn't just come into being a proselyte or an Israelite. They actually were used in God's plan to give a Savior to the world, the Messiah, Jesus Christ. Isn't that amazing? I mean, can you imagine how frustrating and futile Rahab is to a person who doesn't believe Jesus is the Christ? You ever thought about that? I mean, why didn't they have to let a harlot, you know? I mean, Ruth. What's the point of Ruth when you take Jesus out? You ever think about Ruth from an unbelieving Israel perspective? What a wonderful story of redemption Ruth is, isn't it? What a wonderful story of an individual who said, your God will be my God, your people will be my people. Ruth's choice to choose God, and then subsequently God's using Ruth to be the grandmother of David. You know how frustrating that is to a person who rejects Jesus for Savior? But yet it's by faith. And so one of the things that's apparent, one of the things I want to point out first of all is that when we begin to look in our passage of Scripture and we see individuals mentioned, if you're going to take Romans 9 and divorce it from Romans and divorce it from its context, and if you're going to take Romans 9 and you're going to put it through the sieve of Calvinism, of but wanting to believe by your faith that God preselects individuals for damnation or preselects individuals for eternal life, then, my friend, you'll have to do so independently of its context. Because in context, we actually have right in the middle, before we even look at our material, we see our conclusion. And our conclusion is that we come to God by faith. And faith, my friend, is the greatest reflection of the choice of the will that there possibly could be. Faith is not something God orders. I've had individuals take Scripture out of context trying to teach that because everything comes from God, including faith, then God gives some faith and doesn't give it to others. But when you study the Scripture in context, you'll understand that everyone has the ability to believe. Okay, now I want to begin in where we left off last week in chapter 9, verse 1. Paul said, I say the truth in Christ, I lie not, my conscience also bearing me witness in the Holy Ghost, that I have great heaviness and continual sorrow in my heart, for I could wish that myself were accursed from Christ for my brethren, my kinsmen according to the flesh. Now, Paul is here sharing his burden not to impress anyone. In other words, when I look at this passage of Scripture, I'm impressed, aren't you, with an individual who'd say that he is willing to be anathema from God for his kinsmen. In other words, what Paul the implication of what Paul here has said is that he'd go to hell if Israel would be saved. My friend, the eternal nature of hell makes that just a statement that, for me, I'll just be honest with you, I could not make. Man, I'm not going to lie about it. I'm not going to say, well, you know, I'd go to hell because I know it's impossible. You can say, well, Paul knew it was impossible. No, he understood. He just talked about eternal security. He just talked about the inseparable nature of the love of God. And so he knew it was impossible. And yet he's sharing his heart for his brethren. I'll tell you, one of the things that you and I can pick up from this is that here, one who has been called, as we'll see in the next couple of chapters, as an apostle to the Gentiles, wants those Jewish believers at the Church of Rome to understand how much he loves God's people, the Jews, or Israel, according to the flesh. He wants them to understand, hey, listen, I'm not bitter against the Jews. Matter of fact, you remember in Acts chapter 28 when Paul, I believe it's Acts 28, when Paul was being accused by the Jews, and he said, I have nothing to accuse my nation of. In other words, I mean, Paul had some things he could have said about the way that the Jews treated him, couldn't he? Goes to Jerusalem, takes a vow. Every time Paul went to Jerusalem, they tortured him. And ultimately, he became a prisoner and was sent to Rome for false accusations, things he'd never even done or said. And everywhere he went, they brought up, they suborned, or they brought up false accusers. The Jews had treated Paul terribly, and yet he said, I have nothing to say. I have no accusation against my brethren, against Israel. And so Paul loved Israel. Even though he was the apostle to the Gentiles, as Peter would have been the apostle to the Jews, Paul wants us to understand, listen, I don't have some kind of bitterness that is causing prejudice against God's people, national Israel. Because he's about to say some things about Israel that actually are very, very terrible. And he is, if you will, cushioning what he's going to say with the, it's the truth in love principle. He's helping them understand, I wish these things weren't so because of my love for Israel, but they are. So he's got hard, hard truth, but he is cloaking it or cushioning it with a statement or a declaration of his allegiance to and love for the very people who are really going to suffer terrible condemnation, rightfully, deservedly so. I could mention as well that Paul called himself the chiefest of sinners, and so he certainly would not be looking, and he's helping us to understand that the statements he's going to make are not because of a bitterness or an angst against Israel. Again, he doesn't feel as though they're any worse than he was before he came to Jesus Christ. So his prayer for Israel is that they would be saved, and that's what he said in chapter 10, verse 1. My brethren, my heart's desire, my prayer for Israel is that they might be saved. His conclusion, we know in chapter 11, is that Israel, all Israel shall be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. Okay, so now let's look at the material that brings us to where we are. It's interesting as we look at the illustrations that are here. We think of feuds, I guess, sometimes in terms of the Hatfields and the McCoys. Probably this is a little lost on some of us in America. You know, revisionist history and the fact that we just don't think about, you know, a lot of things that, you know, maybe were lore or legend. There's actually a generation today that is so vastly different than the way I was raised, even in knowledge and so forth. It's just amazing to me. I'll be honest with you, you millennials, you're weird. You know, I can't relate to you people. You know, but the fact of the matter is, I'm being silly right now, but the truth is that a lot of what people know today, they just don't know about a lot of history and hillbillies and so forth. A couple years ago, we had the privilege of men's retreat to meet a really good hillbilly. Were you there, Charlie, for that? I'm trying to think who else would have been here. Tony was there, videoed a man by the name of Seven Gibson. His name was Seven because he was seven. Seven of ten. Did you know about Seven Gibson?
Yeah.
No, he was. He was Seven Gibson. That's his real name. His name was Seven because he was seven. And he told us stories about the hills. And I'm going to just tell you something there. He's from Snake Hollow, Tennessee. It's not made up. I went and researched it myself. He's a Melungeon, a group of individuals who origin they're not sure about. They don't know really where they came from. He would tell stories of the things that they do back in the hills. And it just really cracked you up, you know. It's like, wow, I can't believe people still live like that. But he would talk about feuds. They still have feuds up in the hills and things like that. And so when you talk about things like the Hatfields and the McCoys, two families that hate each other and that feud against each other, it kind of helps you understand a little bit of the whole Esau and Jacob thing. The fact of the matter is that there probably was never an angst or an anger or bitterness against people like what brethren felt like Ishmael toward Isaac and Esau toward Jacob. It's hard to understand. I'll tell you something, it's very tough for me to understand. I have observed brethren that don't love each other. I mean, blood brothers who actually hate each other, don't have a natural affection for one another. And I'm always amazed at Esau, actually, and the descendants of the Edomites. You ever read the passages of Scripture where Israel is coming out of captivity, they've been in the wilderness, and they want to pass through the land of Edom? And the cruel things that the Edomites do to the Israelites. And then, of course, you read in the prophets and you look at God's condemnation of Edom because when the Assyrians came and plundered Israel or Judah, they actually gave them passage through their land so that they could plunder their brethren. And then when they would run and hide in the land of Edom, they would say, hey, they're hiding in my house or they're hiding under there. They would actually turn them over and expose them and actually have their brethren killed. Well, you all really hate somebody, don't you? To be able to see cruel, atrocious things done to them and not love them. And so this unnatural hatred of Esau and Jacob has to do, is very similar between today, the hatred of national Israel for the church. You ever have a hard time understanding why an unbeliever is so angry about it? Do you? You know, I don't mind. I'll be honest with you. People think, you know, well, people just think. It's true that I have an opinion about absolutely everything. You do too. Perhaps you just don't tell people what your opinion is. But I do. I have an opinion about everything. If you want to know my opinion, I'll tell you that. I'll tell you what it is. But you know something is, I don't really mind if people don't share my opinion. It doesn't bother me a lot. It's not like, well, this is my opinion. If you don't agree with it, we'll never speak again, or I'll think you're terrible or whatever. The fact of the matter is that is my opinion about that is that my opinion is just an opinion. And so if you don't agree with it, you know, in some instances it could be an important way. If the thing that I have thoughts on or a perspective on is important, well then it could have important results. But the fact of the matter is a lot of things you may just may not agree with me about, and it really doesn't matter very much. But to this Israel and Jacob thing, and the Israelites in the church today, it's amazing to me when I try to share Christ with someone who says, we don't believe that Jesus is the Messiah. It's amazing to me that they're so angry about it. But when we passed out Genesis, John, and Romans in Miami Beach a couple of years ago in canvassed houses, you wouldn't believe how many calls I got from people that said, you need to stop doing this. They weren't okay with me just leaving a Bible. And I told them, hey, well, if you want to, just throw it away. You know, if you want to just, you know, throw the Bible away. Well, you need to come back and take this thing. You need to stay out of Miami Beach. You don't need to be bringing these things into our neighborhoods. People don't want you. It wasn't just a matter of, you know, well, I just want to let you know. It may not matter to you, but I want to let you know that you wasted your money on me sending me a Genesis, John, Romans. It was a matter of, I want you to come and get this yourself. And I'm like, well, if you can probably make you feel good, just go ahead and burn it, you know, or whatever you want to do about it. You know, I'll be honest with you, it's God's word. And if you know, you've got an issue with it, it's not me. I don't have an issue with it, but I'm telling you, they hate me for giving them a Bible, you know, for wanting to invite them to church. And they're very angry about it. You wonder, how can you be so mad about something that you think that I'm just wrong about? No matter if you just think I'm wrong, what difference does it make? How does that affect you? How does it bother you? How is it such a big deal? And by the way, not all Jews would fit that stereotype, but by and large, national Israel is taught to be hateful toward Christianity, toward Christ. And so you want to talk about there being, you know, a place of no tolerance. Try to preach the gospel in Israel. Talk about religious freedom, free society, democracy. The Israeli Jews love to talk about democracy. Try and preach the gospel there and find out how democratic it is, the nation is. I have friends who are banned. They could have gotten aliyah. They could have gone back as citizens of Israel and tried to do so, but because they will not renounce Christ, they're not allowed to be citizens of the nation. And so you try to tell me about intolerance and hatred. There is a lot of hatred. And so the question we want to ask today is, what about the church? What is God doing? Where does Israel fit in God's plan? So here are these Israeli Jews, not Israeli Jews, these Jewish believers in the church at Rome. And the law is very important to them and ought to be, oughtn't it? And their heritage is very important to them. And Paul's about to help them to understand what God is doing with national Israel in their day. Okay, so let's look at just a couple of things. First of all, I would like to look at verses 6 through 13, which really talks about the unbelieving sons. Let's read it. Verse 6, the Bible says, "Not as though the word of God hath taken none effect, for they are not all Israel which are of Israel." Okay, so the statement that's going to be proved in the next several verses, or illustrated in the next several verses, is a statement that all of Israel isn't actually of Israel. You get it? In other words, Revelation puts it this way, they say they're Jews, but they're not. And this is a portion of the scripture where Paul is saying, if you're an unbelieving Jew, you're actually not Jewish. Many of my friends who are Jewish, who are believers, tell me that they've been told by their people. Matter of fact, I had a Jewish person tell me they're not a Jew. If they've trusted Jesus, they're not Jewish. And the actual fact of the matter is that Romans chapter 9 and verse 6 is saying the opposite. They're not all Israel which say they're Israel. In other words, you may have the heritage of being a descendant of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, but that doesn't make you Israel. That is, Israel is distinct from Jacob. Is it not so? In other words, that makes you Jacob, but it doesn't make you Israel. You may be a liar, a trickster, and a deceiver, but you are not the recipient of God's covenant promises. And so, here's the illustration of it. Neither, because they are the seed of Abraham, are they all children. Okay, and here's the illustration. But in Isaac shall thy seed be called. So Ishmael's name is not even mentioned in this passage of Scripture, but what is implied in verse 7 very, very distinctively is that Isaac is the one who had the seed of God's promise. It was in Isaac that God said to Abraham that your seed is going to be called. And so, just because you're a descendant of Abraham does not mean that you're an heir of the promise of God. Any more than that if you're of Israel, that you are actual Israel. You ever read in when the illustration of the carcasses of the children of Israel dropping off in Egypt? And you read the illustration of those individuals who are not believers. They literally, God delivered them as slaves in Egypt, but their souls were unsaved because they did not believe in the God who brought them out of Egypt. So being part of a nation through whom God is protecting, through whom God is preserving, through whom God works, is not the same as being a believer or a follower of God yourself. This is important. In verse 8, that is, they which are children of the flesh, they are not the children of God, but the children of the promise are counted for the seed. For this is the word of promise, at this time will I come, and Sarah shall have a son. And not only this, but when Rebekah also hath... Excuse me. Sorry about that. But when Rebekah also had conceived by one, even by our father Isaac. Verse 11. For the children being not yet born, neither having done any good or evil, that the purpose of God according to election might stand, not of works, but of him that calleth. Now there are a couple of words that I wanted to deal with this morning, and one of those words is the word election, the other word is adoption. We saw adoption in verse 4, who are Israel, whom pertaineth the adoption. The word adoption, interestingly, is used five times in the New Testament, three times in Romans, once in Ephesians, once in Colossians. All of those instances are used by the Apostle Paul. And so in chapter 8 of Romans, we see adoption is used a couple of times. Look back with me, if you will. This has a purpose, has a point. Chapter 8 and verse 15, the Bible says, "For ye have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear, but ye have received the spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba." That is dad. It's a term of endearment for God. Abba, Father. Now, that word for adoption, would it be for those individuals who are believers in the context of Romans chapter 8?
Yeah,
of course it would. Yeah, so these are individuals that, according to chapter 8, verse 1, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. These are the ones who are familiar with the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus. And so, chapter 8, verse 15 uses the term adoption. Who would be included in that people group in Romans 8? Would it be Gentile believers or Jewish believers? Trick question. What?
Both.
It would be both Jewish and Gentile believers. But the ones who the adoption in that instance pertained to would be believers. Now, in chapter 4, or chapter 9, verse 4, the Bible calls them Israelites to whom pertaineth the adoption, and goes on to list all the things that belong to Israel. And so in this context of chapter 9 and verse 4, we're not speaking of all who are believers. We're talking about people who have an adoption, who have a special calling from God as a result of the covenants, as a result of that special relationship they have with God. The word adoption carries with it the word, used basically the word that we use for son. And it has to do with being made the son or being chosen to be the son. And so, is Israel special to God? Is Israel special to God? Is national? I'm not talking about saved Israel, I'm just talking about Israel. Yes, God loves Israel. Friend, I will always, always, always take the position that sides with the people that God loves. And I perhaps won't die for them when they're wrong, but I won't fight against them even if they are. I believe that as a Christian, that I understand that God has things that pertain to them. But I do want you to see in verse 27 concerning Israel. This is a quote of Isaiah chapter 10. Isaiah has also crieth concerning Israel, that, or though the number, did I say chapter 10? I meant to say chapter 9, verse 27. So let me start reading again. Isaiah has also crieth concerning Israel, though the number of the children of Israel be as the sand of the sea, a remnant shall be saved. So understand that though the adoption in this context pertains to Israel, it has nothing to do with Israel's being born again or being delivered. It's going to be a remnant. We read about that remnant. We've been studying in Revelation, haven't we? As we've looked at the 144,000 who were the 12 tribes of believers of Israel. They were only a small remnant of all the of the Jews and the nations, and yet the number of the children of Israel, though it's as the sand of the sea and is today, only a small number are going to be saved. That's Isaiah. It's a quote of Isaiah chapter 10. Second word I want to look at as well this morning is the word election. I just want to simply say that election is chosen. Tony used to do some funny videos making fun of Calvinism and basically God selecting individuals to go to heaven and hell. And he made a t-shirt about election. It showed a stick figure and it showed like a big hand reaching down. There's a line of stick figures walking in a row and there was a big hand reaching down like this and pulling one of them up, you know, and it was to illustrate election. It's actually a pretty funny shirt, but you know, it was making fun of the concept that God chooses people to go to heaven or chooses people to go to hell. So you've been selected, you've been chosen. The word election in the New Testament refers almost universally in most contexts to the church. But here, as we look at verse 11, we see, "For the children being not yet born," this is speaking of Isaac, and this is speaking of Esau and Jacob. Isaac and Ishmael and Esau and Jacob. Verse 11, "For the children being not yet born, neither having done any good or evil, that the purpose of God according to election might stand, not of works, but of him that calleth." Now, believer, I want to help you with something. What does elect mean? Selected, chosen. When it's used accurately in the political season when we elect public servants. We choose somebody for something, when we call them out or select them. Friend, I want us to understand something. It is not a threat to the sovereignty of God for God to allow individuals individual will. And it neither is a threat to the free will of man to acknowledge that God chooses things. What is it about Jacob that was so wonderful? Okay. Be honest with you, when you look at it carefully, he was a horrid parent. He was a terrible husband. You can't find a worse husband than Jacob, honestly. He was pretty good to Rachel, but he was horrid to everyone else. And he wasn't a very good husband with Rachel to take her handmaid and have children with her either, if you think about it. So he's a horrid husband. He was a terrible parent. He did love Joseph and Benjamin because they were Rachel's sons more than his other sons. And you think about what kind of a father would hold it against children whom he conceived. What kind of a father would hold it against them that they came from the wrong mother when he's responsible for it? It's a terrible parent, isn't it? And allow the enmity among his brethren. Jacob was not chosen because he was a wonderful man. Jacob was not virtuous in stealing Esau's birthright. He was distinct from Esau in that he wanted the birthright. But I'm going to tell you something. He didn't know God until he wrestled with him. And he met God, and he was given the name Israel. And friend, the children of Israel, who are not believers, the Bible says, being not yet born, neither having done any good or evil, that the purpose of God according to election might stand, not of works, but of him that calleth. My friend, what of the election? Well, that election is not one that saves them in this context. The children of Israel being descendants, or that is, being descendants of Israel, does not save anyone. Let's continue to read. Verse 12. It was said unto her, speaking of Rebekah, the elder shall serve the younger. So here we see again foreknowledge. God knew that Esau would serve Jacob. As it is written, Jacob have I loved, but Esau have I hated. What shall we say then? Is there unrighteousness with God? Okay, so here's our question. Is God unrighteous because of Esau? Is God unrighteous because of Ishmael? Well, actually, when you look at the parents who raised them, the fact that Isaac preferred Esau and Rebekah preferred Jacob, you have two sons whose parents love them unequally. And you want to blame God for that, that's a little unjust, is it not so? But the question is, is there unrighteousness with God? We're speaking of the unbelieving sons. Is God unrighteous because of unbelieving children? And the answer is no. Is there unrighteousness with God? And Paul's simple answer is, God forbid. Now here he's about to make and hold unbelieving Israel accountable for unbelief. And so the words are going to be harsh, and he's defending the character of God, or he's defending God. Here's an illustration of this. Verse 15 now, the defense of God. So first we've seen the unbelieving sons. Now the question is, does God have a defense? For he said to Moses, I will have mercy on whom I will have mercy, and I will have compassion on whom I will have compassion. I've got a bag of Hershey's Kisses right here, pretty good one. If you guys behave well, you may get one. These are not really bribes, actually, because I'm not trying to bribe anything. It's just if I want to, I give out Hershey's Kisses. It's kind of the way it works. I don't give them out to bad adults or bad children. That's generally pretty well true. Isn't it, Luke? Nobody's misbehaving, gotten a kiss from me, have they? Hershey's Kisses? Okay, I don't think so. You may have noticed before we started the service today that I gave some to some of the kids here today. Now, there's a couple reasons for that. One, they had to freeze to get here. I mean, they braved the perilous cold. The children that rode the bus this morning, namely John and Bella, right? So normally we have, what, 8 or 10 kids that ride the bus. Well, Melissa, you came on the bus too today, didn't you? I forgot about that. So, I mean, they had to ride on a They didn't know the bus had heat, and that they could actually change the climate inside the bus. So they braved the peril and cold. I just thought, well, you know, it'd be nice to give them something nice because, you know, they made it to church, you know, in spite of the danger. I'm being somewhat sarcastic about it today. But sometimes I just throw these at people, like Anthony. Almost every time I see him, I just throw one at him. Good catch, Anthony. And it's just because it's, you know, fun to throw things. It's an excuse for it. And so sometimes after service, if people are standing over by the door, I just fling Hershey's Kisses at them. And they don't really get angry, but Taj gets mad about it when I hit him hard. But nobody else gets mad about it. They kind of like it because they get a Hershey's Kiss. But I'll be honest with you. These are mine. I bought these with my own money. They don't belong to the church. I noticed that some of the kids, when I start handing them out to other kids, some of the kids come and they're kind of like... And I'm like, well, you know, give me five. Yeah, you know, give me five. Like, what's this for? It's like, well, you gave kisses to the other kids. You better give me one. No, that's not how it works. These are mine. And I do with them what I want to do with them because they belong to me. And so I bought them to give out. Jesus, you remember the illustration that Jesus had of the laborers? In the morning he hired them, and he hired them for a penny. In the afternoon, or the late morning, he went and got some more people in the afternoon. At the end of the day, he paid them all the same. And the guys in the morning, when they watched the guys that came late in the day get paid what they were promised in the morning, were like, wow, this is going to be good. If they made that much, and I came so early, worked all day, then I should deserve so much. And Jesus simply asked the question, how much do you agree to work for? It's mine to give. And the idea that somehow God is unmerciful or God is unjust because he's, or to some because he's good to others, has nothing, no bearing on God and his goodness. That's the illustration here. In verse 14, the Bible says, what shall we say then? Is there unrighteousness with God? Well, because God is good to the Gentiles and saves them, is that unrighteousness? Unrighteousness? In verse 15, the scripture says, for he saith, I will have mercy on whom I will have mercy, and I will have compassion on whom I will have compassion. The Bible says in verse 16, so then it is not of him that willeth, nor of him that runneth, but of God that showeth mercy. And so here's where individuals would take the scripture and they'd say, see, it has nothing to do with your will. It just has to do with God's choice of mercy. Well, let's read on. Here's another illustration of it. Or is the question whether or not God is merciful to all men here? Is that the answer? Is that the question? No. The question is whether or not it's fair for God to exclude unbelieving Israel and to include believing Gentiles. That's the question. And God says, you're angry. Because the point here is you're angry because of God's mercy. That's the argument. That's what it's become. In verse 17, for the scripture saith unto Pharaoh, even for the same purpose have I raised thee up, that I might show my power in thee, and that my name might be declared throughout the earth. You read Exodus, you read about Pharaoh, you begin reading after every plague, or before God does something with Pharaoh, that God's doing it. He is hardening the heart of Pharaoh because he's going to use him for an example. But it's very interesting that no one who reads those verses emphasizes Exodus chapter 6 and verse 1. I'll read it to you very, real, real quickly. Because before God ever hardened the heart of Pharaoh, Pharaoh hardened his own heart. Exodus chapter 6 and I had it marked earlier, but I messed it up. Then the Lord said unto Moses, now shalt thou see what I will do to Pharaoh. For with a strong hand shall he let them go, with a strong hand shall he drive them out of his hand. And, I meant to read in verse chapter 5, verses 1 and 2. This is wrong. That was the second part I was going to read. Afterward, Moses and Aaron went in and told Pharaoh, thus saith the Lord God of Israel, let my people go, that they may hold a feast unto me in the wilderness. And Pharaoh said, who is the Lord, that I should obey his voice to let Israel go? I know not the Lord, neither will I let Israel go. Now, if you'll study Exodus, you'll find that God had never hardened Pharaoh's heart. And yet Pharaoh said, who is the Lord? I will not, neither will. I don't know him, and I'm not going to let Israel go. Okay, so who hardened Pharaoh's heart? Who caused Pharaoh to have a hard heart? He did. And what did God do with his hard heart? God said, I can use that. I'll do something with that. And God just, he said, I'll show you hard. I'll help you with hardness. and I'll help you all the way to the bottom of the Red Sea. And that's ultimately what happened, was that God hardened Pharaoh's heart. And so the illustration here is, for the Scripture saith unto Pharaoh, even for the same purpose have I raised thee up. Now again, Christian, understand this. Foreknowledge and predestination are not in the context, in this instance, of salvation. But the word predestination is a distinct word. See, if the Bible said that God predestined Pharaoh to hell, that would be teaching predestination. But the Bible doesn't say anything about that at all. But God knew what Pharaoh would do, and there is not a threat to anything that has to do with the free will of man or the or God's sovereignty for God to allow man to choose and for God to say, I know what man's going to choose. I'll tell you something, Christians have run off and say, well, you know, God, you know, if God knew in advance whether people be saved or lost, then God chose it. No, it means God knew it. God knows things. God knows everything in advance. And you know, you're playing silly games, you're being nonsensical when you think that your day is made up of a string of, you know, predetermined decisions and not choices. Because I've seen you at the fast food restaurant. In other words, you make choices. You say, I want this or want that, or I don't want this, I don't want that. Anyway, we could go on and on with that. But it's actually kind of silly to say, well, you know what, this is my predetermined outcome. I feel this way because God made me. You know, and so that's nonsense. You choose. That's why we have different figures represented in here, because of choices. Because we choose. You say, no, I didn't have a choice. That's just the way my physical makeup is, and so on and so forth. No, it's your physical makeup is a result of your choices. And so is mine. And so, friend, we have to be realistic. When we look at the Scripture, the Bible says in verse 17, for the Scripture saith unto Pharaoh, even for this purpose have I raised thee up, that I might show my power in thee, and that my name might be declared throughout the earth. So the very hardness of Pharaoh pointed to what? Pointed to God's power. Of course, Pharaoh had a serious case of hubris. Pharaoh believed that he was God. He said, I don't know. Who's the Lord? I don't know him. And I'm not going to let the people go. And God said, I'll show you who I am, and you will let the people go. And the bigger and the stronger and the mightier Pharaoh tried to be, the more that he exalted himself against a God with whom he was not a comparison with. Okay, let's finish up where we're going here today. Okay, so is God right then? Verse 18, the Bible says, therefore hath he mercy on whom he will have mercy, and whom he will he hardeneth. So is God right to Pharaoh to harden Pharaoh's heart? Well, Pastor, why wasn't God merciful to Pharaoh? He didn't have to be. That's why. Does that mean that God pre-selects some people to go to heaven, pre-selects some people to go to hell? Not in the least, not in the slightest. It's not the point. The question here is, what is God doing? In other words, in context, the question is, what is God doing with Israel and the church? The question is not whether or not God forces people into heaven and forces people to go to hell. Now, look at verse 19. Thou wilt yet say, then, here's another argument. Why doth he yet find fault? For who hath resisted his will? So here's the second argument. By the way, these don't really have a direct answer. Now, we're speaking, when we speak here of God's will, we're speaking of God's purpose, are we not? The question is, who has ever stopped God's purpose? You know, the events of the cross are a pure illustration of that, aren't they? You look at the people crying, crucify him. Crucify him. What are they trying to do? What are the high priests? What are the Pharisees? What are the Sadducees? What are they trying to accomplish? What's the Satan trying to accomplish? He's trying to thwart God's will. And yet the death of Christ is the greatest triumph ever. In other words, trying to kill God's Son, trying to defeat God's Son, and yet God's will, God's purpose in it was the greatest victory for God ever. So who's able to thwart God's will, or who is able to fight against Him? So, but it's interesting that Paul doesn't even answer this. He just simply says, nay, but O man, who art thou that replies against God? In other words, if you're trying to say, God, why do you have the right to do something? God's question to you is, who are you? Who are you anyway? And by the way, Christian, who are you? I'm not even just talking about the lost who would rail against to make accusations of God. Who are you? Who are you to say to God, God, this isn't good? You know, before you ever pray for healing, you ought to ask God whether or not He wants healing. I know individuals that immediately when you talk about sickness, rebuke it. I rebuke that. Who are you? Whatever I declare, it'll be done in heaven. That's not what the Scripture's teaching there.
That's right.
Who are you? If God wants you to be sick, who are you? And I'd think twice before I'd ask to be healed. I'm serious about that. Many Christians think, no, God forbid it. Well, you know something? God's will for me is going to be either that Christ will come and take me, or His will for me will be sickness unto death to some degree. Who am I? I'll be truthful with you. I'm nobody. That's who the answer to that question is. And the answer to you, your answer for this question is exactly the same as mine is. And the question is Paul's answer is, that's the wrong question. You're going to ask me, why does God find fault? Why? Who has resisted God's will? We know the hypothetical answer to that is no one's ever thwarted God's will. But Paul said, I'm not going to bother answering that question. My answer is, who are you to ask the question? Shall the thing formed say to him that formed it, why hast thou made me thus? Now I've been helped by this verse out of its context to understand that it's never right for any person to look at themselves and have a complex about it. You know, we're all different, aren't we? We're all different intellectually. We're all different personality-wise. We're all different when it comes to strengths and weaknesses, when it comes to abilities, we're all different in every way. Sometimes individuals are angry with God because of the way God made them. And the question is, who are you? Shall a thing formed say unto him that formed it, why hast thou made me thus? Hath not the potter power over the clay of the same lump to make one vessel unto honor and another unto dishonor? Brother Angusath last Sunday brought out his pottery, and he showed us the processes of making a vessel. And he showed us all the different vessels. He showed us how the difference that firing something makes from something that's just made and is just hard because it's dried. And then he showed us how the difference between the glazing and the high temperature makes. And then he showed us the difference between the type of glaze that you use makes on the same vessel. And it's what the vessel's made for that has to do with how you'll make it and what it'll be. And the question here is, does not the potter have power of the clay of the same lump to make one vessel unto honor and another to dishonor? What if God, willing to show His wrath and to make His power known, endure with much long suffering the vessels of wrath fitted to destruction? Yeah, so what if God saved Gentiles? That's the question. Who are you? And that He might make known the riches of His glory on the vessels of mercy which He had afore prepared unto glory. So what if, hypothetically, what if God's will or purpose was to be glorified through the destruction of the wicked? Is God glorified through the destruction of the wicked? Is He? Yeah, He is. Is God glorified by showing mercy to the wicked? The answer is yes. The real question is, who is God? In verse 24, then Paul makes a statement that's inclusive. He said, even us whom He hath called, not of the Jews only, but also the Gentiles. He quotes Hosea 2:23, as He saith in Hosea, I will call them my people, which were not my people, her beloved, which was not beloved. And it shall come to pass that in the place where it was said unto them, ye are not my people, there shall they be called the children of the living God. So the day is going to come that those people which are not my people will be my people. That's God's plan for Israel. So the question that Paul is answering in Romans 9 is not whether or not God preselects or predetermines people to go to heaven or hell. The question he's asking is, what of Israel? What of Israel? And here again, before we even get to chapter 11, where all Israel will be saved, even before we come to that, we are reminded that God has said, I'm not done with Israel. He said, it shall come to pass in the place that it was said unto them, ye are not my people, there shall they be called the children of the living God. Isaiah has also cried concerning Israel, though the number of the children of Israel be as the sand of the sea, a remnant shall be saved. So what of Israel? Well, a remnant will be saved of Israel. Do you know that that is not only true prophetically, but that is also true right now? And it's important for us to understand Israel of today, to know that God saves Israel today. I'm not ranting about this, and I don't have such a strong opinion about it that anyone needs to be offended by it. But I'll be honest with you, I don't have a lot of use for Jewish ministry that is particularly focused only on Jews. You say, why, Pastor? Well, because that isn't what God's focused on. God's focused on preaching the gospel. The truth of the matter is that Jews get saved just the same as Gentiles do. Where did the first church begin? Jerusalem. What was it comprised with, ethnically? Jews. So did Jews get saved in this dispensation?
Yes.
Are Jews part of the church?
Yes.
How does a Jewish person, a person who is Israel according to the flesh, how does he come to the saving knowledge of Christ?
By faith.
Same way a Gentile does. By faith. Okay? It is so frustrating to me that ministries focus on preaching the gospel to the Jews differently than they do to the Gentiles. It's the same gospel. I'm not against the Isaiah trail, if you will, or preaching the gospel from the Old Testament. It's just that it's a shadow, and it's a figure of the things that is to come. And we have the whole thing, my friend. We have the whole covenant. You can read Jeremiah 31:31 and read about a new covenant that's promised, and you can read it because we can hold it in our hands. And it frustrates me sometimes that individuals, I'm not against focusing on a particular group of people as in, hey, I'm going to go preach to the kids today. Or, you know what, there's a lot of Hispanics in this neighborhood. We're going to go reach them, or we're going to whatever. Listen, if that's who's there, preach to them. But an individual who preaches the gospel somewhat exclusively really doesn't capture the heart of God when it comes to it. I'll be honest with you, I'm not comfortable, and for a lot more reasons than just this, I'm not comfortable in a church that has no diversity in it unless it's just an area that has no diversity. I remember moving back to go to seminary to Pensacola. One of the things I looked for in a church was that it wasn't a bunch of white people. You know, and in that area, there's so much racism that churches were either black or white or Hispanic. It was like when I found a church where it was believers, and it was then I felt comfortable. Because that isn't the way God is. God isn't that way. God doesn't see ethnicity. God made man in His image. There wasn't something so marvelous about Abraham, or there wasn't something so marvelous about Isaac and Jacob. It was just that they loved God. They believed by faith. You read Hebrews chapter 11, you'll find all these individuals are in heaven because of faith. Because without faith, it's impossible to please Him. For he that cometh to God must believe that He is, and He's a rewarder of them that diligently seek Him. Now let's finish. Verse 28. We begin to come to our conclusion. We saw that the right to accuse God is not ours. Verse 28, for He will finish the work and cut it short in righteousness, because a short work will the Lord make upon the earth. So God's going to finish this work. What does that mean? It means God isn't done with Israel. The covenant promises that God made for Israel. See, we began by saying about Israel, to whom pertaineth the adoption, the glory, and the covenants, and the giving of the law, and the service of God, and promises, whose are the fathers, and of whom as concerning the flesh Christ came, who is over all, God bless forever. Amen. Listen, God's not done with those people that have those covenant promises. God has not replaced Israel. See, it is so popular today with individuals who believe in pre-selection to say that God has replaced Israel. Our friends, the Presbyterians, believe, and the ones in America in particular believe that we are Israel. The church is national Israel. And that's why they strive for things like reclaiming the culture. They think that our country is saved and not individuals. They think that they're pre-selected to salvation and that it's not an individual choice. You say, Pastor, D. James Kennedy used to teach evangelism explosion. I know, he learned it from Dr. Lee Robertson. He believed in the gospel. But he was an exception, actually, not the rule. God doesn't choose people, my friend, for salvation. But God has a plan for Israel, and ultimately, the Bible says that He's going to finish the work. So the question is, what of Israel? That's the question in Romans chapter 9. Well, we're not finished answering the question, but the short answer today is God will finish the work. God isn't finished. And you and I as believers, if we're going to draw application from this, first of all, need to remember this. First of all, take advantage of the mercy of God. First application is take advantage of the mercy of God. What if God would say, I will have mercy on whom I will have mercy? That's what He told Moses. I will have compassion on whom I have compassion. In verse 18, therefore He hath mercy on whom He will have mercy, and whom He will, He hardeneth. What if God has mercy to you? My friend, there's a warning here, isn't there? Don't harden your hearts. That same warning is in Hebrews. Don't harden your heart. Don't harden your heart. It may be, if you decide that you're going to harden your heart against God, God will use you for an illustration of His righteous and His right will to condemn. But God's merciful, my friend. You study the Scripture, you read Scripture, one of the things we know about God is that the Lord is not slack concerning His promises, as some men count slackness, but is long-suffering to usward. Long-suffering, same word that's used here. not willing that any should come to, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. So what is God's desire toward every individual who's ever been born, including Pharaoh? That they be saved. That they receive mercy. And what's God's desire for you? You may be here this morning and you say, I don't know if God loves me or not. My friend, God does. God does, so much so we could read in Romans 5 that where sin abounded, grace did much more abound. In other words, more sin there is in the world, Jesus Christ's righteousness was greater than that. Well, we could read in the Scripture, we could go to 2 Timothy and we could look at how that God will have all men to be saved and to come into the knowledge of the truth. God loves you. We could look at John, where the gospel is most simply laid out and explained, and where Jesus himself said, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have eternal life. Later on it says, he that believeth is not condemned, he that believeth not is condemned already, because he hath not believed. We know that there is therefore now no condemnation them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus hath made us free from the law of sin and death. What's the distinction between individuals whom God is going to judge and whom God is going to harden, or whom God is going to use as a glorious illustration of his holy character and nature through destruction? Well, it's just simply a choice of faith, a choice of belief. And Romans 9 is not in any way contradicting what we've been taught, what we've learned all the way through. God hasn't suddenly, you know, said, well, you know, now come to think of it, with Israel it's different. And he's changed the gospel. No, we've learned that the gospel is by faith, and this passage of Scripture concludes that the gospel is by faith. Let's look at that conclusion one more time. What shall we say then? Verse 30. That the Gentiles, which followed not after righteousness, have attained to righteousness, even the righteousness which is by faith. Verse 32. Wherefore, because they sought it not by faith. Why is Israel today not part of God's plan? Why is Israel today not being used of God? Why is she excluded?
Unbelief.
Because she sought it not by faith. In other words, Israel today is all about laws. It's amazing how individuals want to make laws for themselves that cannot even be kept, and they prefer that to faith and the help of God's Holy Spirit. But it's so. And it's not exclusive to Israel, that type of unbelief. It's any individual. I appreciate that in this context an Egyptian is mentioned, don't you? To help us to understand that this isn't just, well, God elected Israel for these purposes, and now he set her aside because of his divine will, and they have no choice but to be condemned until it's time for him to work through her again. No, my friend, it's so that God can be glorified through mercy. Through his mercy. And Israel will be condemned by unbelief. My friend, in our congregation, we have individuals who are national Israel, yet have believed God by faith the same as anyone else does. Because God will have all men to be saved, and those who come to God come to him by faith. Paul himself, when he uses the word us talking about Israel, is himself a believer. So what is our conclusion this morning? Well, friend, you and I don't have the right to accuse God. Verse 33, as it is written, behold, I lay in Sion a stumbling stone, a rock of offense, and whosoever believeth on him shall not be ashamed. And I've never heard a person who preaches predestination in the context of salvation ever read verse 33. They don't have that in their Romans. They've only got a few verses in the middle. Because the Bible says, whosoever believeth on him shall not be ashamed. And our conclusion this morning is a simple question. Have you believed in Jesus? Trusted Christ as your Savior? And the second question would be, if you have, would you be among those who would find fault with God? Who would lay charge against God's elect? See, Paul is not writing this to the lost. He's writing it to the saved church at Rome. And his question is, who are you to reply against God? Why do you find fault? And friend, I just have to be as truthful as I possibly can. If what individuals who taught the doctrines of Calvinism, they call it the doctrines of grace, but it's not grace. If those individuals were honest about it, they've created a cruel, unjust God. The fact of the matter is that he isn't so at all. We have a God whom it is possible for anyone who believes on him not to be ashamed. You say, Pastor, well, they don't have a choice in their belief. My friend, that's nonsense, and it's a misunderstanding of the very word belief, which is faith or trust or choice of the will. Have you believed in Jesus? Secondly, do you recognize God's right to be merciful and to judge those who reject Him through unbelief? Father, thank you for what we've learned this morning. I do ask that you would increase these truths in our hearts. And as a result of what we learned this morning, Father, I pray that you would help us to have a better understanding of your plan with Israel. Lord, I pray the next several weeks as we begin to focus on Israel and what you're going to do, that we would know you in a more distinct way. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to have an invitation this morning. The invitation is very, very simple. First, it would be if the words saved or believe or lost or even talking about Jesus and his death and burial and resurrection or words like the gospel would be words that are foreign to you or are not personal to you. That is, you'd understand that this way. You'd say, you know something? I don't know what God thinks about me. In other words, I talk to the average person who believes in God, and most of them think that they're going to go to heaven, but when I ask them what God thinks about it, most of them say, I don't know. What does God think? You think you're going to go to heaven? Yes, I do. Well, what does God think? And they say, I don't know. Well, my friend, you can know what God thinks because of promises in the Scripture. See, Jesus died for your sin. And we're all sinners. We've all come short of the glory of God. And God wants you to be saved. And friend, if you've never trusted Jesus as your Savior, and it's simple. It'll just be as simple as recognizing and asking. God, I recognize that I'm a sinner and that Jesus died for my sin. I'm asking you to save me because of what Jesus did. Jesus was God's perfect Son who never sinned, who was God and yet became like sinful flesh and yet didn't sin. And he died for sin. And God sent his Son. He made a promise. Jesus said this. He said, whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Jesus said, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that was himself, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. And friend, you can have everlasting life on the basis of the truth that salvation is universally offered. What's the difference between the saved Jew and the unsaved Jew? Belief. What's the difference between the Gentiles who never had the law and yet they are saved? They have the righteousness of God. Faith. And today by faith, which is simply believing, you can put your trust in Jesus. That's the invitation for you this morning. If you're here this morning and you'd say, well, you know, Pastor, I've struggled with the character of God. I've struggled with whether or not what people say about God are true or not. I don't know. My friend, the conclusion of Romans chapter 9 is that the difference between people whom God condemns and uses in righteous judgment and those whom God saves and is merciful toward is a matter of belief, a matter of faith. If you'd settle that matter and just say, God, you know, I don't know all the ins and outs. I don't understand everything about it necessarily, but I'm going to believe this about you. Then you'll have a straight view of God. You know, if you have a skewed view of God, it's an evil God, and you'll be frustrated trying to serve an evil God. It isn't the God of the Bible. It isn't the God of Israel, and it isn't the God of the church. And so that may be a matter for you in the invitation this morning. I want to turn to page 248 in our blue hymn books. If you're physically able to do so, will you please stand? We're just going to sing a hymn of invitation. You need to be saved here this morning. Would you just come forward during the invitation or even motion to me, and I'll come to you if you're not sure about this matter of eternal life. And we'll make sure we take care of that before the invitation's over. You're here this morning, you need to do business with God. You could do it right where you're at. Instead of standing and singing, perhaps you could sit and pray and let God have His way in your heart. Why not now? We'll sing, and as we sing it, you do business. Mm-hmm.